So I'm going to start with a new project. Okay. So I'm going to create two projects actually. First project, I'm going to only tell how Cucumber can be set up. Second project, how in a simple project API can be triggered. And then I will combine these two, how to make use of both together. That's the whole and sole agenda of today's class, so that you guys can understand what I have done here in Cucumber API automation, where I have merged both the things. Okay. And ask. Continuously interrupt me and keep on asking. At least people who are present today, at least 3-4 people, at least you guys should be comfortable in understanding this framework, and I should see some progress next week. Okay. So I'm going to start with new. I'm going to start with the Maven project, right? So Maven project, next. Skip. Everyone knows what archetype is, right? Don't know? Okay. We'll talk about it. It's Maven. It's a Maven concept. We'll talk about it. Just note it down that you have to ask this. So I'm going to give it some name as Vision IT Cucumber Sample, which I'm going to delete later. Okay. Cucumber test sample. Finish. So I have a project called as Cucumber test frame, right? Then you guys already know what needs to be done. We are going to have our POM set up correctly first. So I'm going to copy and paste few dependencies. Okay. First and foremost, I will copy this one. Let me close all the open files. First and foremost, I will open this. I'll copy this much. I will paste it here. Okay. So what I'm instructing it to do is 1.8. And I have another property file called as 4.2.0. Okay. I'll go and dikh raha hai nahi to come closer. Or two people can come here. You guys can come here so that they can come forward. Okay. And secondly, I need few dependencies of Cucumber. So let me tell you what those dependencies are. I think everyone knows, I don't know if you don't know it or not, Cucumber is not originally written in Java. It was originally written in Ruby. Okay. Then Cucumber team and along with some other Java and different platform teams, they came together and they started creating bindings in different languages. So in Java, they created a binding called as Cucumber-Java. So this is what is needed if you want to run Cucumber in Java. Okay. So this is the first dependency which we need. Second, Cucumber JUnit. Now Cucumber needs a helper runner which could trigger Cucumber, right? In this case, it's JUnit, right? So we need this dependency as well. Then of course you need JUnit, because you need to create that you need to make use of that JUnit annotation called as run with. You remember when we create a runner, we type at the run with. So you need that as well. So it's JUnit. It comes in the JUnit. So you need this as well. So these three you definitely need. Now there is another dependency called as Cucumber Pico container. Now Pico container is a separate dependency. It's a separate piece of software which can be used for dependency injection. What is dependency injection? We have discussed it in detail in previous classes. I'll not shy away from explaining it again, but not today. Okay. But if you need it, if you need to have dependency injection in your framework, then you need to do this. Now, few frameworks in a real-time environment can use Spring, right? So their dependency will be called as Cucumber-Spring. So if you go to a Cucumber website, no, if you, let's say you go to a Cucumber tutorial or something. Not here. Let's say here. So here you might find Let's see if I can see. So there are multiple documentation here. If you can go, by the way, if you want to learn Cucumber, don't go to different various sites. That's the first mistake people make. Okay, they go and search for different websites, tutorial.com or Guru or Toolsway. If you want to learn a software, go to their official site. That contains the latest information about that tool and in the simplest language. Other tools are developed by different, other websites are created by different people. They have different backgrounds. They create their code based on those backgrounds and it confuses you, right? To understand Cucumber in the simplest sense, follow the website. That's what I do. Okay. Later on, when you need some advanced things to do, then you can go around and check here and there. But first, refer it. So you will find this is a website where you can find all these things which I'm telling you. Dependencies, dependency injection, what are dependency injections, how Gherkin works, all those things are present here. Anyway, I'll just for time's sake, I'll quickly copy it. So I need these four dependencies. Rather, I need only these three. This is an extra dependency which I need. Because if I want to do a dependency injection thing, I can be able to do that, right? So I'll copy this much. I'll paste it here. How to remove this here? So I'll copy it here. Right? Paste it. Sorry, saved it. By the way, I need to have a dependencies tag here. I need this inside this. Done. Now it is still 1.5. I need it to be a 1.8. So I'll go here and the factor will path. Maven update project. So if you want to forcefully implement what the changes which you have made in their form, you should. Can go and Maven update and it will do it. As soon as I do it, it will happen. Right? Then now I have a project in which all the dependencies are there. That's the first thing which you need to do. Second thing which you need to do is if you are very new to Cucumber, then you need to go and add that plugin from Marketplace. Right? Otherwise, it will not identify that feature file. It will still work. So that plugin has nothing to do with it. Nothing. It will not be used to execute your test. Execution part, Maven can take care, dependencies can take care. But if you want to see something similar to this, so that you know this is properly readable, then you need that plugin, which comes under, I think at least Marketplace, and you need to search for that Cucumber thing. I don't know. Huh? Natural plugin. What is natural? Okay, I don't know. Right, perhaps yes. So basically that plugin is usually for identify Gherkin syntaxes. Right, chalega. So plugin, see plugin you are installing in Eclipse. Eclipse in general has no impact on the code which you are writing, right? Because when it comes to execution of it, all you need is a SRC folder and pom.xml file. That's it. Getting it? You don't need any other thing. So though you don't even need Eclipse altogether. Okay, so pom.xml and SRC folder is executable in itself. No matter what kind of ID you are using. These things just help you in, you know, doing things better in a more efficient manner. Right. For example, if I want to go to a specific line, I can directly go from here and go to that method. Right. Sorry. Syntaxes. Syntaxes. Not even syntaxes. It just make manageable. It makes things manageable. For example, even for TestNG, this is the same thing. Right. If you are not installing TestNG plugin, will TestNG not work in your machine? It will still work. You can just have to add the TestNG pom dependency in a pom.xml file and it will execute it. It's just you will not get an option right click run as test engine. But you can still run it using pom.xml. I did on your Rahul's machine. For him, test engine plugin was not installed. So what I did, I just added a pom.xml there, and from Maven build, I was able to run TestNG test. So you will not get these options, for example, run as TestNG test. You will not see it here. That's the only impact it would have. Otherwise, if I go and run using Maven build, Surefire or Failsafe plugin will, you know, eventually can execute your tests. Okay, we'll see here. Okay, let me close again because I don't want to you to be confused about it, right? So this is our original POM file, is it? Clear? Now what we do is our feature files will be inside resources, code inside test, right? So what I'll do is I'll create a small package. I'll give it a name as package features. Then I'm going to create a new file, new. I'll give it a name as other. I'll say a file, a simple file. I'll give it a name as my first feature. Finish. As soon as I create this, you see a lot of things automatically came here. How? Because I have installed that plugin. If I did not install that plugin, what would have happened that in that case? A simple file would have been created and I can easily go and write these steps there, but these syntaxes will not be highlighted. These intelligence will not be there, but still it would have been an executable file from Maven. So from Maven, I would have easily executed it. That got it. This indicates it's a comment. Tag is similar to your group. Feature means name of the feature file. A single feature file can have multiple scenarios. Each scenario represents your requirement or your test case. Okay? It's up to you how you want to manage it. Just to relate or correlate it with the stuff which you have already done in the past, understand each scenario as a test case. It makes things easy to understand and comprehend, you know, from the putting it into contrast with the older version of the framework which you have done. Okay, so this actually represents a test case. In BDD environment, this represents a requirement, and each requirement can have multiple test cases. But let's not get confused. A scenario is a test case. Okay, so for example, if this is a yes, otherwise it will not identify it. So this syntax will be remain as, for example, this is a feature file for search, right? So I'll say, okay, search functionality. And I can give some details. Checking search feature of e-commerce. Okay. Validating filters. What I'm trying to do is details. Mm-hmm. Yes. Right. So these tags are something which represents, in some sense, this is a mechanism to using which you can group, categorize your scenarios and features. So I can say this is for search. So if I want to run only search-related test cases, I would be able to do it. Then here I can give scenario-specific tags. So let's say this is for search. Let's say this is for filter. Right, let's say price filter. This is for sorting. Yeah, sort. Getting it? So this is how this gives me some control over how I wish to run my scenarios and feature files. Something similar to groups, categorizations. Okay? In that sense, it's required. Got it? Now, let me do one thing. Okay. Yes, why not? So you can say this is filter and this is smoke as well. This is smoke regression. People also do something like this at the rate. Jira. So this represents, let's say your BA has come up with a requirement. and requirement is 2, 3, 4, 5. In the requirement, he has written all the details of the requirement, and you're writing test cases in the feature file, which represents that requirement. So let's say you want to, you know the ID number and you want to run only 2, 3, 4, 5 test cases. Sorry, only story number. User story number. This is also very prevalent across test projects. Okay, so this also you can try. Important thing regarding tags is they have to be predefined. So everyone in the team should be aware about those categories. It's not that today you want to, you're writing scenario, you are giving some tag on your own, like whatever. So this will not work. You should have some set of predefined tags which everyone in the team know, and everyone should know what tag to give to which scenarios while trying to create it. Right? So what kind of tags we can think of as of now? So you can say smoke, regression, this can be common tags. Then you can say module specific, right? So you can say search, add to cart, payments, checkout, these are module specific. End to end, right? So end to end, these kinds of tag you will discuss within your automation team, and you will say, okay, wherever I want to give some tagging, it has to be, you know, among one of them. And if, let's say, there is a new category came up, you guys will discuss and you will add it. So, okay, next time this tag can all, this is another tag which can be given. Otherwise you can't control it, right? If you're not defined, if you haven't defined the proper groups among yourself, how will you define it, right? People can give anything. So how would you can't, because there will be times when you will be having like 100 feature files, each having 50 scenarios, let's say, in the extreme cases. How will you know which tag has been given when? And you wish to run, how will you control it? Control things that way. You can't. Right? So you need to have those definition of tags. That you will give only these number of tags. It can be given to feature level, it can be given to scenario level. Fair enough? Fair enough? I will say tag. Tag one. I'll resume. I'll revert what was there before, okay? Right, so let's say I want to create this test case. Right now I'm going to say it's a search functionality. Okay, now what to do next? How will we go and run it? Can we run it first of all? Right, so we Cucumber via, you know, use we can execute this feature file via Cucumber command line. Okay, from there we can mention lot of things, feature file and all those things. If you want to customize things, then you need to make use of a tag called as Cucumber options. So by default, Cucumber assumes that if a feature file is in a specific folder, its step definition is also present in the same folder. That means by default, Cucumber expect that step definition file to be present inside feature. But it's not the case for us. If we are using Maven project, it will not happen. The folder structure will be different, right? So we need to do that customization, and Cucumber says if step definition files are not there with the feature file, then you have I'm giving you an option called as Cucumber options. From there you can mention features where feature files are kept, you can mention where glue is kept, and you can also mention few other settings and properties for report generation. Okay, right, so you don't have to mention Cucumber options. It will able to find it. Okay, but we don't want it, right? We don't want it. So what we'll do is, that's the first thing from command line, right? Now we don't want it. We want it to be executed from our runner file. Okay, we want a runner file because we are not going to run it directly, because we will use Maven to run it, isn't it? So when Jenkins will execute it, or let's say anyone wishes to execute it, they will not run Cucumber. They would like to run from pom.xml file. Eventually that's going to happen, right? So we need to provide a runner file. So that's the existence of, that's why we use runner file. Where will we go and create a runner file? Inside test. So I'll create dot runner. Guys, you're getting the basics. Huh? So next time I don't want to listen or hear. I don't know from where to start. This is a basic I am telling you, bilkul basic, from the scratch. How will you start? So it's for Rahul. Okay. New class. In the new class, I'm right. So this is again important. I explained this yesterday. If you're going to give it a name as runner or whatever. Okay. In that case, form.xml surefire will not automatically execute it. If you are mentioning a keyword called as test, then Surefire will automatically pick it up. But this is something weird. It might sound weird to you. I'll tell you how it works. Okay. Right now, I'm going to give it a name as runner test. Let me append a test inside this for now. So I'll say finish. This is a simple runner file. Rather, it's a simple plain class file. I want to configure it so that Kumbhar can be configured from this class. So what I'll do, I'll add an annotation to run with. Excuse me. Now this run with is an annotation of provided to us by JUnit. So I'll say JUnit. Okay. Then inside this, I have options. What should I write? Run with Kumbhar.class. So now I am instructing JUnit to run this class via Kumbhar.class. So Kumbhar.class is what it will take and it will execute it. So basically JUnit is being triggered and it is executing Kumbhar. Okay. Sorry. No. This Kumbhar class is just an API. Dependencies. Dependencies aya basically, yes. Kumbhar.api.jnun.kumbhar. Ye kahan se aya? The dependency which we added here. As I said, no. This dependency is required if you want to run your Kumbhar via JUnit. Is it the only way to execute Kumbhar? No. Kumbhar can be triggered directly via command line. You don't actually have to go and use this. But I don't want to do it because I have a Java project where I want to structure my stuff in a better and more efficient way. So I have created a class in which I am using JUnit to trigger Kumbhar. Okay, because I'm using Eclipse, I don't want to have a command line, right? I want it to be eventually executed from POM and all, right? And POM is capable of POM. In POM, you have a plugin called a Surefire. The Surefire will execute your some class, right? Some test. So I cannot provide that command line stuff for Kumbhar inside POM. So it's better to do it this way. So it does exactly the same thing. It's not as very different than that, right? So classes, you see here, Java docs is also coming. So classes, annotation, @ run with Kumbhar class will run a Kumbhar feature. In general, runner class should be empty without any fields or method, for example, like this. What it's saying to us is class mein kuch nahi likhna hai. You shouldn't be writing anything in the class. Only the annotations will provide things. And at the top, if you see Kumbhar options, plugin pretty. No mention of feature, no mention of glue. Okay. Got it? And all the details are already present here. Cool. There are a few more things here which you can make use of for before class, after a class. I'm going to skip it for now. We don't need it as of now. Okay. I'm going to keep things simple. Yahan tak samajh mein aaya? What next? What next here is you see. Second annotation is @ Kumbhar options, etc. etc. What I'll do? I'll add a Kumbhar options bracket. Okay, inside this, I have an option to provide different various information. So first information I can provide about features, features. Glue plugin. Plugin is basically used for if you want to execute some piece of software along with Cucumber. So as in Cucumber, as if you are using, let's say, Chrome, you want to enhance the Chrome's capability, you will use a plugin, right? Same way, Cucumber allows you to implement on top of Cucumber. So let's say extend report is a separate entity, right? They wanted their reporting to be part of Cucumber framework. So they created a plugin for Cucumber. And if you want to call that extend report here, you're going to add that as a plugin. If I just show you, I tried doing that. So I'll just show you how that looks inside your runner file. So where is it? Runner. So see, I've added this line here, com.eventstack extend report Cucumber. What this does is, that's how you implement extend report for Cucumber. Extend report for Cucumber. So all I'm telling you right now is, if you want to enhance the Cucumber's capabilities with the help of some separate software, either you're going to go and create a dependency for it, and you can also plug in that inside Cucumber using plugin section of the annotation which it provides you. Okay. No, so it depends on the plugin owner, right? How they wish to implement it. So if I go and if I show you this as well, let's say what I've done here is, so I wanted to implement extend report. So extend report guys, I went to their site. They said we have developed a jar file. So it's named as extend reports Cucumber 4 adapter. So I have added the dependency. Yes, yes, yes. Especially for Cucumber, they have added this. And add to Cucumber 4 as an adapter. So it is easier than the previous version of extend report where you have to actually go and write the extend test, extend scenario, all those things, right? This adapter part, you know, you can, it takes care of all the other boilerplate code which you had to write earlier. Now you don't have to write those things. We are not focused on extend report right now, so don't worry anything about it. My whole and sole purpose of explaining all this was that if you want to make use of some extra features inside Cucumber created by someone else, this is the place you're going to write it. And only if the plugin owner wants it to. Right? For example, we are also using Pico container, Cucumber Pico container. Are we writing it here? No. Because it's internally added. Okay? Here, you had to write it. It's as simple as that. Okay? I will move to delete these files. Sorry. Runner test. Okay. Now, instead of writing things, or let me write it, right? So you mention this here, like this class path, and then you write features, and then you write my first feature dot feature. That's how you mention the feature file. If you're not mentioning this, that is also fine. That means whatever feature files are present inside this feature file, all will be executed. Okay? If you're mentioning specific feature file, only that feature file will be executed. If you want to mention multiple feature files, so let's say I have another feature file, feature 2. Right, so I'll mention something like this. My feature, okay. And the name of the other feature file. Okay. No. So, it's just an option which you can give. Ideally, you should only give the package name, which is features. So this folder name is features. Then you can control the execution paper using tags. So you should not be mentioning individual. Let's say you have 100 feature files. So will you mention all the feature files? No, right? I'm just telling you how it could be done. It could be done in this manner. Okay? Ideally, it should be something which is very straightforward. That is this much. This much is enough. Got it, Ravi? Ever? Have you guys ever tried doing it from scratch? You have you tried it? No, you tried it?
Yes.
So try it from scratch. What I'm telling you, just try it, do it again, and then jump onto the framework which I am asking you to work on. Okay. Now in the glue, what you will do? Right. So in the glue, I will say, I haven't created a package. So I'll write a package called as step def. Should I name it step def? No, not necessarily. You can give any name. It's a standard that this file contains step definitions, right? So I'll say this is inside step defs. Okay. What should I mention in the plugin? Pretty. What does pretty means? Pretty. In terms of reports. So in Cucumber, you have an option to create different kinds of reports. You can create a JSON report, an HTML report, an XML report. Now you might think, why we need JSON report? Why Cucumber create JSON report? Who will go and actually read that JSON, right? It's actually used for, if you want to customize your reporting. Let's say you have a separate reporter and you not accept JSON. You have a, for example, in my project, I created my customized reporting. So I didn't use extended and all those things. I created my own HTML, right? So HTML creation is fine, but you need to fill that data inside HTML, right? Like what is passed, what is failed, what are the steps? So all that information I need to have from somewhere. So when Cucumber executes, it can create that JSON and the XML, which I can read, parse, fetch data out of it, and embed this inside HTML and then show it to the actual user. So for that purpose. So if you have a customized reporting, in that case, you might need it. Secondly, Jenkins actually uses that JSON report. So Jenkins has a plugin, which then it reads the basically JSON part of that execution report, and it displays in a separate HTML template of its own. Okay, got it? So I'm only telling you that if you're using some separate reporter, JSON XML file can come handy. Okay. Second thing is, so this is plugin one. Second is, I also can give an HTML test output Cucumber report. This will actually go and create the Cucumber HTML report. So whatever it was there in JSON, it actually converts it to a HTML file format. Fair enough? So far, so good. Step defs. Okay. Let me have some water. 1 minute. Okay, cool. Right. Now what next? Now we have created a feature file. We have created a runner file. What we don't have is step definitions. Right? So you can go and create your own step definition files. Right? You can go and create methods and all those things. But better way is to take that information from Cucumber. So what Cucumber has this feature, which is when you execute a step definition, and if when you execute a step from feature file, and if it doesn't have any step definition method, it will create it for you. The definition part, it will create. Okay. How? I can just go and run it. So I'll go to runner test. Run as JUnit test. Let's say if it doesn't. So see, it is saying I have tried executing this all, and unfortunately, I couldn't find any step definition. Missing with the snippets below, right? So it's saying, I have generated it for you. Please use it. First thing. Second is, let's say your feature file, this is your feature file, right? Let's say you have a specific arguments here, and it is as written as a double quotes or as an integer. It will understand it. So if you see here, for the first step. I want to write a step with precondition. Is there argument here? No. Now if I go and run it, and now I go run a test. I go and click run as JUnit test. I want to establish it as a string, and it is created a parameter as string. So when you write your feature files, you should write in a manner which is predefined, that you already know about it. Okay, getting it? Huh? Okay, good. Let me remove these tags. And everyone knows what the scenario outline is. So this, I'll explain. So this scenario outline is used for data-driven feature. Let's say you want to run the same set of steps, but for each different row, each time for different row. Something like data provider. Okay. So I want to write a step with name as this value, value as this, and verify as status. So first, the same set of steps will execute for this, then this. So twice it will run. So Cucumber will understand it as two scenarios. Okay, got it? Now let me also show you if I go and run this via Maven. Okay, so let me run it from command line. I'll go here. See, this is a step which is, where is it? Oh, okay. Where is it? This one. Cucumber test, this is a folder. This is what I have, right? So what I'll do is I'll start a terminal on this. So in your case, it will be command prompt, okay? You open CMD inside and I'll write Maven clean install. Right? So it has created the steps. Okay, now let me also take this opportunity to explain what I was talking about earlier. So if I go and rename this, and I just gave it a name as simple runner. Now my understanding says it will not execute anything. Let's see if it happens or not. End of story. Okay, so this is what I was talking about. What I was trying to explain was that when Surefire tries to execute it, Surefire is a plugin which is present inside POM. How will it know what to execute? Right? So its by default behavior is first check across all the framework, across everywhere, that rather than the test part of the Maven, that is there a method annotated by @test of JUnit type or a testng type. If it is there, it will execute it. Then also check any class file whose name is test. That is test coming in the beginning, end, or in between? If it is able to find it, execute that. Okay. Previously, I was having this name as runner test. So it was executing it. I renamed it to runner. It was not executing. Right? But it's not that you can't change it. Let's say you wish to keep it as runner. You don't want to add test here. Still, you can ask Surefire to run it. But this time, you need to tell Surefire that include this. Right? Something like this. So if you want to run, let's say now this time, I want to execute it. So what I'll do is I will inside configuration, Maven Surefire configuration, I will add these lines and I'll write something like this, which is runner. This is a, no, no. So this is a separate POM file. Right. It's commented. Right. I just written here just to explain you, because I don't need this. If I am giving the name to my runner file as test, I don't need this. I'm only going to need this if my name is different. And it doesn't harm to give a different test name to your runner class, right? So there's no point of configuring this this much. But if you want to, you can do this. That's what my whole and soul funda and purpose of telling you all this. Name of the test file. Name of the test file. So name of the test file should be like this. Why am you telling you all this? You know, so that you, if you go to a real-time project, you will not be confused. You know, you come up with these things. I don't know. Yesterday it was working, and now it is not working. So when things stop working, or things are not working altogether, there is a reason behind it. So I'm, this is a very small thing which I'm telling you. Very small. Many people might not be even aware of it. Right? Why I'm telling you? Because I struggled. Few years back, I struggled with this. The same thing appeared to me. I somehow renamed the file in an existing project, and all of a sudden, everything stopped working. I spent like 3-4 hours understanding what happened, and then I realized, okay, the name is important. Then I realized, okay, test is has to be there. Only then Surefire will execute it. Okay, so I am passing that information to you. At the rate test?
Or the test name.
Test name.
So, the test name including step definition?
No, no, doesn't matter. Name of the file.
No. In step definition, we are creating the classes and having some method. So, if there, any file having the test name. So
no, it will not.
No, only runner file.
Because it will not even, because if you, if we, Surefire, even if Surefire will try to execute that step definition file, it will not execute because there's nothing executable there, right? If you are giving it name to a file as test, there has to be something executable inside it.
So consider it as an executable.
What? At the rate test?
The name of file is having some test
name
in step definition.
Okay, let's say this name has test. Let's say this step definition file has test in its name. Assume. Do you have anything executable inside this? No. That this given is not executable all, you know, by itself. It has to be executed from somewhere else. It's not a triggering point. It's not a main method. Understanding it? At the rate test annotated method is self-executable. Main method is self-executable. Only these things can get executed, right? If you're saying I am giving it a name as step def as test, this should also execute. No, main, Surefire will. Surefire will read it and say, okay, there's nothing to be executed. It will go ahead, even though you're giving it a name as test. JUnit. Run with, it's clearly written here, run with cucumber.class, and that's what it executes. First thing is, it will go and check all the class files which has test written there. Second check, if there is a test within there, it will go inside. It will see, is there anything to be executed? Is at the rate test annotation is there? Is run with annotation is there? Yes, executed, no, forget. Getting it? Something like soldier coming to each door and checking, is there any terrorist? Terrorist, yes, kill it. No, go ahead. Room to dekhi liya. Okay. All right. So, right. So once I have created a feature file, I'll go and rename it again. Okay. So let me quickly refactor it. Finish. Execute it again. Run as JUnit test. I will copy it. And I will paste it here. Where inside I'll go and create a step def file, class file, a simple class file. Okay. And I will finish it. So my, okay, I'll go here, cucumber api.java.en. Then all the when statements. And then all the then statements. Fair enough? Okay. So now I have created my step definition file. Now the actual coding will start. So all the logical steps which you need for creation of your test cases, you're going to write inside these statements. Now if you go and run it, it will every time it will throw an error saying that I couldn't find it. Because every time you are running it, it's throwing an exception that this method is not implemented yet, pending exception. So you have to remove this line and write your actual code, whatever it is. That we will talk about later, because you want to implement API inside this. Okay. Now one last concept. So let me reduce the scope of this first. There are too many statements. So I'll keep things simple. I'll remove this as well. Okay. It can be a red scenario. There is another tag. Tag, no, that background. This concept called as background. Inside background, you can mention given. Remove it from here. So for each scenario.
For a single scenario, some step has to be done multiple times.
Which step? Fact,
either it is given or then.
So.
Other chance steps then. You make test case multiple times.
Okay.
You only one step, then see test case multiple
times. For what purpose? I mean, you need to tell me.
Let's consider the IT not a valid scenario. We are trying to check with valid username.
Valid username.
Until and unless it is not getting valid address domain, it's not going to enter into the website. So, given try. In third attempt, it got successfully that this domain is valid, and then I can press the login button or something.
I can't say I understood your question well, but the point is, whatever you're going to write here should be very readable and very simple. Idea is this should be simple, and core behind it has to have all the complexities. Now what you're trying to do is to bring complexity here, which is not a good case. So if you anytime want to do something like this, which you're mentioning that I want to run one thing but again and again, it's anyway is a wrong approach. It can be done, but it's a wrong approach. So it's always don't do it. So let's say if you want to run this line again, you will do this as the end. So this will actually a given statement only. Right? So anything can be done from here, but it will not be called as a good approach, because the purpose of having a feature file is so that you understand it as an automation tester. Manager understands it as a management person. A client who has no idea about whatsoever about how this whole thing works, they also understand by just having a peek at it. That's the whole and sole purpose of having a feature file. Right? So you have to refrain from adding any complexities to the feature file or so scenario. It should be very simple. Even in few projects and even my projects, we are not allowed to write this many statements. All we do is given, when, then. We don't even are allowed to write this ends for each scenario. That you have to divide your scenarios in such sense that all the scenario, that small snippet of scenario can be expressed within these three statements, given, when, then. Right. What I'm trying to explain is how to make it readable. What is the right way to use it? Readable nahi hoga na, because that's what I'm saying. When you're writing the scenarios, you don't write it from your perspective. Write it as if someone else will read it. How would they feel when they read it? This is what you need to take care in your head. And you need to divide your scenarios to a maximum granular level possible. Smallest of the smallest piece of requirement is what you should put here. So we have been educated in a wrong way, in some sense. The wrong way in the sense, make things together so that it becomes reusable. Right? So what we try to do is we try to merge a lot of complex piece of code inside one, and that's why we take pride in it. You see, why I have merged everything together so it becomes reusable, it becomes anyone can just change the argument and do it. It's not always a good approach everywhere. Because when you make things together, it makes things rigid and complex and difficult to understand. Rather, divide things. Okay. So here I am asking you to divide things. Make things smaller and smaller and smaller. So that it becomes readable, better executable, better maintainable. Effect of one scenario will not cascade it to the next. Right? So there has to be balance between reusability and distribution, distributability. When you try to make reusable, you tend to make it as a centralized version of something, and that makes it rigid. Okay, I'm just talking about the philosophy of how you philosophy of a good design in some sense. I'm not expert on it, but that's what I've learned so far.
Small.
Here as well as in your code as well. In the code also in step definition file you're putting everything. No, just try to divide things up.
Lesser.
Right. Point is, this should be readable. That's the gist of it. It should be readable. The moment you put and then and your scenario becomes this big, it's complex. Sometimes there is no option to do it. This is not easy thing to do. What I'm asking you to do is not easy. Even I sometimes struggle to do that. But your target should be towards that. Success rate could differ, but you should not be pleased and saying, okay, I've written this much and this is very beautiful. You should know if the moment you write things bigger, it's not readable. The comment itself will not be readable enough. Okay. Enough. We have discussed on this. Let's move forward. Okay. What I'm trying to tell you now is it's a very simple example of how you're going to write the steps. Title of a scenario. Let's say I'm saying, want to add two numbers given. I have two numbers. 1 and 2. Okay. And when I add these numbers, then result is 3. So this becomes my expectation. These are my arguments. Okay. What I'll do, I'll go to step definition and I can manually change it, but I will rather not do it. I'll remove it and I'll ask Cucumber to generate it for me. So I'll run it again. JUnit test. Lines have been created and see it has also taken care of the arguments. So int. Go back. Step defs. Okay. I'll remove this. Now I can write my actual code. So I'm saying there are two numbers. So these two numbers have been passed as an argument here, int 1, int 2. What I can do is, what to do next? Here, it's only a given statement. My actual operation has to be here when I add these numbers. So how will I pass this from here to here? Huh? Right, so I'll create a variable at the top. Okay, I will say simple int number 1. Okay, A. It's fine. Int number 2. Int result. Cool. And then I will assign this here. So number num1 is equal to int 1. Number 2 is equal to int 2. Okay. Now I can make use of these numbers here. So when result, here are the actual operation. Result is equal to int 1 plus int 2. Okay. Sorry. Number 1, number 2. Right. And the third, I will put some validation. Oops, sorry. So this number, which is int 1, will be my expected, right? Expected. So I'll say if result is equal to expected, then I can say assert dot assert true, right? So I'm making use of JUnit assertion. JUnit assertion, which is what I'm using right now. Okay, and then if not, then false. We'll say false. Fair enough. If I want to run this now, let's see what happens. So if I go here and say run as JUnit test. So it has executed. Scenario one, 3 steps, passed, all passed. Now let's go and have a look at the report. So where is the report saved? Inside target. So I'll go refresh in the test output actually, because that's what I given there in the Cucumber options. Open with web browser. So I'll see I have 2 numbers, 1 and 2. I had these numbers, result is 3, right? Now this is what a default reporting looks like. Let's say you want to add some statements, like something similar to testng-reporter.log, right? So that is available using a concept called as scenario. Okay, where will we put it? So this scenario object is an interface given to you by Cucumber. Where we use it? So I'll write here public void test, or let's say before hook. So this is called as hooks in Cucumber. All the before, after, these are called as hooks actually in a broader frameworks, test frameworks. And at top of it, I'm going to write @ before. And if I click on it, I get 2 options, Cucumber and JUnit. Use Cucumber API.java before, not this one. Otherwise, things will not behave as you wish them to behave. I use this. And here I'm going to write scenario S. Cucumber.api scenario. Okay. Then I'm going to create, again the same problem will appear here, right? Because this is being passed as an argument to the method. How will I make it available in all the methods? So that's why I need to create the instance variable. S-C-E-N-A-R-I-O scenario. I'll say S-C-N. And here I'll say this dot S-C-N is equal to S. Okay. So before, no matter which, in which step definition file it is written, it will always run before any scenario. Okay, and after scenario is over, another step, another annotation called as after. Will get executed. So I'm adding both of them here because I have made use of this in my framework. So Cucumber API. Fair enough. And here I don't want to do this because already it is present here. Right, so I don't want to actually do this. All I would do is perhaps scenario dot write scenario is completed. And it provides lot of methods actually. So scn dot, so I can say okay. Okay, so this will tell you that whether scenario is passed or failed. Okay, so scenario has rather lot of methods. So see, get ID, get lines, get name, source, text, name, status, embed. I explained this yesterday as well for appending the screenshots inside your HTML report. Okay. And this object is now you're going to use inside your steps. So you can write something like this here, scenario dot write numbers to be added are number 1 number 2. Right? Then I can say numbers added. Result fair enough. So this is something which you can use for writing it up. Scenario.write result matched with expected. Did not match with expected. Okay. Yes. Yes. Why not? Nothing. See, the purpose I'm telling you. So, purpose of having this and having this is
to find that instance variable.
This you cannot use directly. So, I have explained this. I'll say it again. Dependency injection. This is a pure case of dependency injection. I always, I used to tell you this as well, that you have used dependency injection many times, but you just didn't know about it, that you're using it. This is an example of it. So this scenario S is an example of a dependency injection. It is called as native dependency injection of Cucumber. Okay. For this, you don't have to add any external additional thing, additional framework. Scenario S is an interface. As soon as you run it, as soon as you run any scenario in Cucumber, an object is created. Object type is scenario. And it gets injected in the before hook if you write this. If you don't write this, nothing will happen. Your code will still work. But if you're writing this, then scenario object will be created at runtime with all the details and it will be injected. So this is called as dependency injection. By the way, how do you create an object? You create object name equal to new object. That's how you create an object. Second way of creating an object is either you will pass it, right? So you create an object somewhere, you call a class and you pass the object to it, right? Here, I'm not passing anything. I'm not creating object of step depth, right? I'm not passing anything in the before hook. Are you passing anything in the before hook? No. So Cucumber is creating this object, the scenario object, and it is passing it. Yes. Cucumber does that. It's Cucumber's mechanism to interface se wo uska object banata hai, implement karta hai, and it creates it at runtime. I don't know if it's interface or not. So I think it's interface. If you see here, see I. So it's Cucumber's mechanism of
implementing classes from a web driver driver is to new Chrome driver.
Something like that, yes. But you don't have to worry about it. Cucumber is taking care of it. Some sense, yes. Some sense.
So that's why we are not writing the same dot right over there.
Right. Its whole and sole purpose right now is to read this and attach with that. Because if you are passing it here, how will you make use of this object here? Directly cannot, right? So you need to create an instance variable and assign it. Okay. Cool. So now if I run it, I actually ran it again, right? Did I? No. So if I go here and run it again, run as JUnit test. So this time, see, this time I get to see the information here. See, it's a false and is failed false. I wrote there is failed. You're saying false. It's not failed. That means it's false. True. Okay. So you might kind of think right now or worry about ki what else I can make use. Where else I could just make use of this object. There are many places, many areas where you can make use of it. Right now, just be restricted towards scn.write. There are a hell lot of things where you can use it. And these all, again, I'm going to say it again, this all can be used for reporting purposes. That if you need to make sure of what lines, name, ID at runtime, what tag is being executed at runtime, so whether you can write it somewhere, right? For all those purposes, you can make use of this object. It provides you some default information about what it is which is executing at runtime. समय है इस बात का मतलब नहीं समय है आ गया ना सो दिस सिनेरियो ऑब्जेक्ट इज यूज्ड एक्चुअली इट कंटेन्स ऑल द इंफॉर्मेशन ऑफ व्हाट इट इज एग्जीक्यूटिंग एट वन टाइम दैट्स अ स्टेटमेंट ठीक है राइट नाउ वी आर ओनली यूजिंग इट फॉर राइट सो फार सो गुड नाउ आई थिंक सिंस आई हैव ऑलरेडी एक्सप्लेन डिपेंडेंसी इंजेक्शन फॉर दिस let me explain you one more concept of dependency injection. Okay, I'll try my best again to explain it. Just try to understand because you have already kind of understanding this scenario thing, right? So I'm going to explain that concept also. It was not planned, but let me do that. Let's see how much you are comprehending it. Okay, and ask if you're not able to. Now the point is, this is called as native dependency injection. So what you see here right now is a native dependency injection scenario S. That is, Cucumber is by default giving you that. Now, what if I want to inject something else, something of my own, an object which I think I need to inject in all the step definition files, which will carry the information. Let's see how. Now, let's take an example of another step definition file. See, I'm trying to attempt something very bold and very, you know, I'm not sure how much you will understand. But let's see. Okay. So step def file. Base class. Right. Yes, you can do that, but that's not a very good approach. Right. So the point is, sharing the information using a base class can be one of the approach, but when your project size is small, it becomes very good. As soon as your project scales, it becomes difficult to manage. So the concept of dependency injection came into being because to handle these issues. Right. Okay. So right now what I'm doing is sharing of information or state. It's called as state sharing. Dependency injection is used for state sharing concept. That whatever happened inside a method has to be shared in a different method. So for that, let's say you have only single step definition file. So you see here number one, number two. Then result variable was saved here, right? It was easy for me to send this information to this method. How? Because I just created an instance variable, right? So it was easy for me to do in a single step. So I have shared the state of this method variable to this method very easily. How? By doing this. What if I want to share this information across two class files? Okay, so that is what I am trying to tell you. How? Why we would need it? Let's say I want to write my given statements in a one class file, when statements in second class file, and then statement in a separate class file. So let's try to do this. You want to take a break or something? Huh? Let's just finish it off and then we'll take 5 minutes break. 5-10 minutes break, and then we'll do API. Okay. As I said, I didn't want to do it, but I think people are following me, so I'm trying my best to explain this. Okay. So we factor. So I'm saying I'm going to place all my when calls here. I'm going to add all my given statements here. And I'm going to add all my step defs then statements here. So now the actual problem will come. Problem is, all the then statements I'll cut from here and I'll put this inside my then. So this will have only then, right? This will have all the only the when, all the when statements. So right now I only have one when statement, and this will have only given, right? Now if I run it, it will fail terribly. Why? Because all the class files have their own separate instance variables, which are not shared. So right now, let's say I'm here in when section, it will have no idea about what result is. And if this information I want to send inside the then part, then it will not have idea about the result. In this case is null. So information is not shared. One way of doing this is, as we discussed earlier, base class. You define this in base class, right? So you create a base class somewhere, and perhaps let me just create it for you. We can say base class finish, and inside base class I'm going to add this information. I'll cut it. In the base class I will say base class, I'll say protected. Then everywhere I will just extend this. Extends base class. Base class. Can I try running this? Let me remove all these things. So this also I'll go cut it and put inside base class, that is here. Okay, I think now this should work because now a state is shared. Let me remove this. Fair enough. I think it should run. If it doesn't run, then don't judge me. I'm also trying this for the first time. Given the class? Save new one. Oh, okay. Thank you. Eagles aaya. Baaj ki nazar. Failed. That defined extended. That defines your hooks. Okay. So actually, I'm not allowed to do this. This should be part of a specific step definition file. So it should be somewhere inside this. Null point exception. No, doesn't matter. That's what. So again, another concept. It doesn't matter where you're writing what. If you're writing before and one step definition file, it will be treated, it will be fetched at runtime for that scenario. So step definition has no kind of one-to-one binding with the feature file. It will scan all the step definition files. And in any step definition file, if it is able to find that before hook, it will execute. So it doesn't have to be inside any specific step definition file. You can have it anywhere. Getting it? So first, let's solve this null point exception scenario. Okay. So see, even from base class, it's not working. What is not working is this scenario thing. So in the given part, I have this S here, and I'm trying to use this here, and somehow it is not returning it. So this is for this S, where it is failing. It is failing here. So this scenario.
The situation is like from the base class, we are sharing the only instance variables.
Right.
Okay. The when part is sharing something written back to the base class, then base class having some changes in its variable, then it's given to them, and then the result. Which is not the case. If base class were written in the
right. So see, it's not exactly the case. Right now what I'm trying to do is to do something in a wrong way. I can make this work, but this is not the right way. Let's understood this first. Okay. I'm just trying to make a case that you can do it this way also, which we can. And which is happening also. If we don't use the scenario part, no, it will still start working. Okay, so it's happening inside the scenario because of the scenario dependency injection sort of thing. So that's why it's happening. Otherwise, it will still work. Okay, but my agenda of this all, you know, of me telling you all this about dependency injection. Okay, let me cover that. So how dependency injection works is, by the way, I can try doing one more thing. Instead of using before, I can do one more thing. I can write public perhaps I can try doing this as well. Scenario. Okay. Okay. But I am not wasting my time here. Let me tell you the dependency injection concept. Okay. So let me just tell you that. I'll create a class called as, I'll name it as scenario context. It's an independent class. Okay. Inside this, I'll create few variables. Okay. So variable can be my int number one, int number two, int result. Okay, and I will be injecting this inside my class. How will I inject it? Inside constructor of step definition. Okay, so what I'll do now is, instead of using this base class, I'll place everything as it is here. Okay. What I'll do is here I will write SCN context. Context. Getting it? This dot context is equal to context. Okay. So what will happen by doing this? By the way, I have to do this in all the step definition files here as well as here. Are you guys following me? Okay. Right, so dependency injection usually in this case will be injected via constructor only. Who is facilitating this? It is the POM, it is a dependency which I explained earlier, Pico pentane. Getting it? So if I do this step depth given, and I might have to do this everywhere. Right. So I'll remove the base class concept now, okay? Because I don't need it. So I will remove it, okay? So let me review it. So first we created a context file where everything is there. So object of this will be created at runtime, okay? Then it will be injected here, context. And same object will be part of all the class files. So don't understand it as a different. So it will be something like a string, you know, mala pehante hain, to usme beech ka string, and all the pearls embedded inside it. Embedded as I know, mala jaise banti hai hamari. So your context object is that string, and your step definition are your pearls. Okay, something like this. This is your context object. This is your step given step definition. When step definition, so this object is shared across all. Same object. So if you this step definition kisi method mein, if you going to go and change some property of this context file, it will be reflected everywhere. That's the purpose of dependency injection. Okay, let me show you. So here number one, number two. Result, and then in the context, number one is here, number two is here. So this is given, okay? Int one, int two. So this is what you have to save here. Let's say if I do this dot number two. Okay. Are you guys following what I'm doing? So see, you see, no. Here I have passed it. सबसे पहले given में आएगा. I have passed this object here, and I have saved number inside that object. I have saved number one as value, number two and value, so that when it goes to the then, or sorry, when it goes to the when part. I will use the same object to pass number one and then number two. Okay, and this I am going to save here as result. So I am easily passing my state across different variables. Okay. So I'll remove this. From here, inside then, this will be result. So I am not making use of the instance variables. I can actually, right now I'm directly using it. I should ideally actually go and fetch this value, put inside variable and make use of it. I am directly using it. Okay, I will just try running it once. If it doesn't work, we'll leave it. I'll make it work, then I'll post it. There's no point of wasting further time. Okay, let's see if it works in a single go. If it works single go, you can consider me as a genius. If it doesn't work, then I'm just like a normal human being. Okay, and I 100% sure it won't work. See, some null point exception. I think this is only because of the scenario dot write. Why this is not being shared is perhaps I didn't share it actually. Did I? Step depth given. scenario is not being, let me pause it for a minute. Otherwise, right. So now if I do Maven clean install, test executed, it is completed. I'll go here. I'll open target, not target, test output, Cucumber report. 411, right? It was just created and it's pass, right? It's working. Now let me again explain what I did from where we left off, close all. So I'm going to delete this base class. There's no point of doing it from base class. I want to expand this Pico container. So click on OK. I created a separate file for passing the state. Okay. This is a my own file. I can do anything inside this. I can create my own objects, methods, anything. But whole and sole purpose of having this file is so that I will identify what data I want to pass across different steps, spread across different classes. Passing state between two methods present in the same class is easy. We just did that. Passing state between methods kept across different class files is difficult. So you can make use of base class, but that's not advisable. Instead, we are using a dependency injection framework called as Pico container, Cucumber Pico container. For that, we have actually added this dependency. Okay. What it does is it injects the object of the class which we created for passing the state, right? It injects it inside the step definition class via the constructor of the step definition. See, so we don't have to actually write anything else. So Pico container is considered to be the cleanest way of dependency injection. If you had to use Spring, so in that case, a lot of things has to be done. So you need to write something called as auto wire on top of it, where you want to inject something, all those things, right? Pico container is very, very famous in the sense it is less intrusive. Intrusive, less intrusive means you don't have to do anything else. Just create the constructor and add the object as an argument there. And what it will do at runtime, it will create the object of it and it will inject it. And once it is injected here, you assign it to the instance variable of that step definition and make use of it. Okay. Same way for then. In the then also, I have created this object scenario context. This context I am saving at the instance variable here. Okay. And in the then I am directly using it context.result. So actually methods are doing the actual work, but the variable values is actually being saved inside this. Okay. So all these variables are being used here. Right. Right. Okay. So this is what it is. Now let's say this is a Cucumber with Selenium. This is the place where you can define your web driver. Let's say you have a driver and you have a given when then statements. That given your browser is open, then when navigated, then something happened. And given when then is different in a different files. So you need to do get in this file, driver.get, driver.find elements in second file, driver.click perhaps in a third file, third class files, right? How will you share the driver across all, driver object across all? So you need to define it something like this here, like web driver, driver equal to new Chrome driver. And you can directly make use of that. Right now I don't have, I'm just writing pseudo code sort of. And that you need to define here. So that web driver D and context, sorry, D is equal to context dot driver. Okay. So everywhere, wherever, and no matter in which file, which method this is being used, it will be using this object's property, which is driver. Not getting, getting right? Okay. Yeah. Ask. Yes, yes, ask. Okay. Pausing. Okay, so I've tried explaining this complex concept of dependency of injection. Step definition given. And then everywhere I'm injecting here. Pico container only allows this object to be injected via constructor, but there are other frameworks, dependency injection frameworks, which allows in different manners, not only in constructors, there are method injection and different kind of injections are there. But this is the least intrusive and least time consuming when you wish to implement it, right? I see how quickly I implemented it, right? Secondly, if I go and I'm removing this. If I go inside my POM and I remove this, for example, I am removing this constructor. Sorry, this dependency, this Pico container. And now if I try to run it, it will give me an error. It will say, let's see what it says. JUnit test. See what it's saying? It is saying, doesn't have an empty constructor. If you need DI, dependency injection, put cucumber pico container on the class path. Intelligent. What it is saying, ki bhai, you are having a step definition given. You have a constructor and it's a parameterized constructor and you're expecting this to be inserted here at runtime. And I have no clue how to insert it. If you want a DI, add a pico container or some other injection framework. Right? Why it is doing it? Because at runtime, it is trying to create an object of this. Step definition underscore given ka runtime pe object create karta hai cucumber. Because cucumber ko kya karna hai? Cucumber wants to execute this method, right? So if you want to execute a method, you need to create an object of it. Cucumber at runtime tries to create an object of it. Okay, and you are having a parameterized constructor. So that means you need to create an object by providing that information in the constructor part while creating the object. So it is not able to do it. If you are having Pico container, it will automatically create an injection. That's called as injection. Yes. Agar Pico container, sabse pehle. So, sabse pehle, it will first attempt to create step defs given object. It will not be able to because this is not there. So it will go and create this. Once it is created, it will go and add it here. And then it will create the step definition given object and it will call the method. I have two numbers. Yes. Okay. Getting it? Now, just one last thing. There's also concept called as transitive dependencies. That's a Maven concept, transitive dependencies. But in this case, let's say this itself this is an object which you wish to inject and this also has a dependency. Getting it? Not getting it. Let's say there is another class. There is another context class. Okay. So that will also be sorted out. For example, this I don't want to put here. I want to put this in a separate class. So first this object will be created. It will be injected inside this. Then this will be injected there. Right. Second option to do this is, it's not that you have to add only one. You can add multiple class files here. Class scenario context this, then scenario context one. So you can have... This is like you can directly doing it.
Normal.
If you multiple. If you want to do a chaining kind of thing, then you can put it there. Why I'm telling you this? You never know what kind of frameworks you're going to work on, where these things are implemented. So it should make sense to you that this is also a possibility. Right? Because sometimes there are a lot of things are happening inside a framework and it's not that simple. There could be a lot of objects, different objects being injected from different classes. And eventually everything is merged in a single object and it will send inside the, you know, given statements like this. You should know what data is coming from where. Okay. So I'm trying to explain all that complexity using a simple example. That's my attempt right now. Okay. Okay. Let's wind this up then. So this is the simplest case. It's 4:25. Okay. Let me stop the recording.